Sports Hot Seat is brought to you in part by Sport Buff in Plaza Lexus Neon, where you'll find the entire line of starter sportswear.
Welcome to another season of the Sports Hot Seat, and we've got a special one for you. Part one of a two-part series with two of the best ball players in the National League, maybe in all of Major League Baseball, Delino DeShields and Marquise Grissom. Also, of course, back this season, co-host Mitch Melnick.
Mitch, welcome back.
Welcome to you.
And a very special welcome to Messrs. Grissom and DeShields, who, yes, are not only two of the finest ball players in Major League Baseball, but you're going to find out a little bit more about them off the field here and why they're as popular as they are. Guys, welcome. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you, Mitch.
Are you guys great friends? Are you bosom buddies? Are you just close friends? Or you just can't stand each other and this is all an act? Which is it?
I don't know him.
Really, I don't like him too, like that. I mean, that's my boy and everything, but I don't like a lot of things that he does.
Like?
What don't you like that he does?
We ain't gonna get into that on TV.
But. Let me ask you a question. You guys are always associated with each other. You came up around the same time. Your careers have taken off about the same pace. Does it bother you at all that it's always Delino and Marquise or Marquise and Delino?
It bothers me. You know, like when you ask me to come on the show and you're like, I'm getting Delino too, and I'm wondering why can't you just, you know, get him on the show by himself or get me on the show by myself or whatever.
That don't mean he don't like me, though.
Yeah, that don't mean I don't like him, but everybody can put us together. Every time we do a card show, every time we go somewhere, they always say, Delino and Marquise, and every time I go somewhere, I'm Delino sometimes, and I'm not.
But you understand, Delino, why fans are so passionately enthusiastic about discussing the two of you together. When they talk about their team, Montreal Expos fans talk about Delino and Marquise as being those two great ball players playing great, exciting ball at the same time.
Yeah, I can understand where they're coming from, but at the same time, they have to understand that we're individuals, and we have our own individualism, and, you know.
You're very different, in fact, obviously, as individuals. So what would you say, from a personality standpoint, your biggest differences are?
He's stubborn.
Yeah.
And I don't know. People just don't, you know, they don't understand him or me as well as we understand each other. You know, I know myself and he know himself. And that's why we get along. I know him and I know how he is and I know what he does. And so I accept that, and that's that. And I don't go any further, but, you know, people just think, you know, me and him do the same thing all the time, but we don't.
Would you say you're closer to being actually opposites in terms of personality than?
I would just say that we grew up in two different parts of the country. You know, I'm from the north, and Marquis grew up in the south. And, you know, a lot of things that he reacts to, I might not react to it, or I might react in a different way. So that's probably the biggest difference in us right there.
Have you learned anything from your friendship with each other? Must be a lot of similarities baseball-wise in how you've come up together.
Well, it's just a lot of well, he's from a large family where I'm an only child. But as far as our paths coming up, you know, through the ranks or whatever, there's a lot of similarities.
Do you have a natural, you know, I don't want to read too much into what's inside your head, but you what's 16, family of 16?
15.
And Delino's an only child. Do you feel a natural gravitation towards being a brother because of your upbringing?
Hmm. Mm-mm.
No?
got enough brothers. He doesn't need another one.
Nah, I look at him as, you know, as a friend. We played together in AA, AAA, and we pretty much came into big leagues at the same time. And it's just we've been at the same stage and at the same level, and we try to teach each other as we go. We never stop learning, and that's why we get along, too, because we communicate well. We're about the same age, and we came through at the same time.
Do you share some of the same interests off the field in terms of music, hobbies, or movies, or books, or whatever, anything like that?
Yeah, we do. Music-wise, and going out together, but he read a little bit more than I do. He try to educate himself a little bit more, and I don't do too much reading, but everything else, we pretty much do the same thing.
Now, you each have a child that's close to the same age. You just had little Bop, I don't know if you call him that yet, but Delino Jr., I guess, 8 months old now.
Mm-hmm.
You got a son, 14 months old. Mm-hmm. Your kids had a chance to meet each other, I would imagine, during the off season, or at least in Palm Beach during spring training.
Yeah, they done kicked it a little bit.
They running around.
They're going to have plenty of time to do that.
Marquise's kid must be beating on your kid. He's 6 months old.
He
already getting it.
Yeah.
Is fatherhood what you guys thought it was going to be like? I mean, there's a lot more to it than wait. I mean, believe me, just wait a couple more years. But is it pretty much what you thought it would be? Is it better?
It give me something to look forward to other than baseball. You know, I can go 0-4 or go 4-4, and after the game, I'm thinking about my son. And it just made me a better person, a stronger person, and I don't have to worry about myself anymore. It's not just me, it's my son now. So it's been a big difference, but my main concern is the well-being of my son now.
I interviewed you, Delino, in spring training, talked about how your son changed your life, and you said that he did change a lot of the outlook and philosophy you had about life when Delino was born.
Yeah, well, growing up only child, I've basically looked after myself. Been concerned with myself, and I've done everything for me, and now all of a sudden I got this little one, and it does change you a bit. It's not just me anymore, you know, I gotta look out for him now.
Has it changed the way you react to other people, not just to your wife and to your child?
I don't think so. I'm not as judgmental anymore, you know, because I gotta raise my son and do the best I can with him.
How quick were you to judge before?
Real quick. Because I just felt like, you know, if it was wrong, I was going to tell you about it. You know, I might be wrong, I might be right, but I don't do that anymore because I know that, you know, my son's going to be looking at me, so I got to do the right things for him.
Have you guys thought about, because of what you do for a living, how you're going to relate to your kids, your son at this point, your sons? They're going to grow up watching you be in the spotlight. And It's not like most other fathers who work 9-to-5 or whatever. Have you thought about how you might handle that?
I have. Well, I think just along the way, each year, as he grow older, just you know, tell him to, you know, education first and to be himself and to be real and just take him through as I came through. You know, it was different for me.
Just be yourself.
You know, when I came up. But he gonna have better things than I had when I was his age and better living conditions and everything. So I hope he use that to as an advantage and move on and be even, you know, better than I was.
Both of you must be very proud that you're gonna be able to provide so much more for your family than what you had growing up.
Well, I think that's every man's, you know, wish or whatever, just to be able to provide for his family, and not a lot of African-American men are able to do that, so of course it feels good.
What do you think you'll do differently? Your kids will grow up with millionaire, multimillionaire fathers, and you're gonna have to keep those kids leveled down to the ground. It's a whole different mindset, I imagine, than what you grew up with. They won't have to work that hard to get the things that you had to work hard to get.
Yeah, they will. I mean, my son, he's going to have to earn what he gets. You know, he's going to have a lot of love and a lot of this, that, and the other, but he's going to have to earn it.
You think you'll spoil your kids at all? Or will they be automatically spoiled having Marquise Grissom and Delino DeShields as fathers?
Already. My son is already spoiled to a certain extent because I'm not there, you know, every day. And she buys him everything, and he has everything. But he's going to have to work for everything, I think. You know, just because we got it, I'm not going to just keep giving and giving and let him keep making mistakes. It's starting now, though. You know, you can't wait till you get 4 or 5 and try to discipline your child.
I don't want to talk to you as if you're the same person because we've already been through that. Are either or both of you going to be strict fathers, real authoritarian fathers?
I don't think I would be.
Well, me personally, you know, I feel like discipline is something that we've gotten away from. It's like, oh, you can't beat the children and this, that, and the other. But I got beatings when I was young, and it teaches you sometimes when you don't listen and mind your parents. Sometimes you got to go upside their head, you know. So I'm not saying I'm going to beat my kid to death or nothing like that. But, you know, if he gets out of line, I got something for him.
Describe your childhoods in 30 seconds. What are they like?
60. You can take 60. 60. It's okay.
Mine was long, hard. I did a lot of things. I learned a lot during the ages of probably 6 through 15. I think that's where I got all my discipline. My mom and dad did an excellent job, I think, raising 14 out of 15 kids. So I have to thank them for a lot of my stuff, you know, for the things that I did and to my success right now.
Childhood in Seaforth, Delaware?
It was pretty much like anybody else's, I guess, you know. Not a lot of money, a lot of love, grew up fast.
You basically took care of your mom, though, didn't you?
Well, I mean, just here recently, when I got into pro ball, I had the opportunity to finally do something for my family. And that was probably the biggest reason why I didn't go to college. You know, I just wanted to help my family out.
I think most Montrealers know that you could have played basketball. And you still play basketball, but obviously not for a living. Have you ever given it any thought that, geez, if I had just waited or maybe, you know?
Sometimes. I don't have regrets, though. You know, I just wonder sometimes if I could play in that league, you know, with Michael and Patrick and all those guys.
Marquise, was sports a big part of your growing up? Outside of baseball, you do any other sports growing up?
Yeah, I played pretty much everything.
He can hoop, too.
Can he?
He can ball a little bit.
I can't hoop
not
like
him.
No, I can't play
him.
I tried to guard him in Atlanta in a
me,
basketball game, and he hit 30 points on me. NBA threes.
What'd you play, football?
I played football and basketball. And playing sports in high school, that was my way of staying out of trouble. I had to play. If I didn't play sports, I would have had all the extra spare time after school, and I think I would have took the wrong direction. But that's just a decision I had to make at that time, and I made the right decision. I think I did.
Hope so.
I think it's fair to say you're still learning baseball. When did you first pick up a glove?
Guess I was 7. I remember my dad taking me out and buying me my first glove. I was 7 years old.
And did you use it a lot?
Yeah, I played a lot of baseball when I was young, but I didn't have the love for that game that I had for basketball. You know, it was just something that the neighborhood kids did. You know, whatever season it was, that's what we played. We didn't play hockey, though.
Have you acquired a love for baseball?
Well, yeah, it's my livelihood. I mean, that's what I do now. So, yeah, I do have a bit more passion for it than I did.
Bobby Hurley of Duke talks about playing so much basketball in Pennsylvania in the projects, and that's why he became the ball player that he did. Is there a certain camaraderie about project basketball that you just can't find in organized baseball?
Well, project baseball or project basketball would be like sandlot baseball. I mean, just picking up some cardboard and throwing it out there and going at it. You know, that's what I could compare it to.
Did you play sandlot baseball?
Yeah,
stickball, wall ball.
That's all we had. You know, we didn't have umpires out there in back of the school. We just went at it. You know.
Same thing for you?
Yeah, basically. You know, me and my little brother, we used to play all the time, and my next door neighbor, and that's all we do. We get a tennis ball and a bat or a stick every day. After school, every day.
Who did you want to be? Who did you pretend to be?
Nobody at the time. I was...
Me either. I never...
I didn't really want to be nobody. I went into baseball that tough until I got drafted.
You both grew up without a lot of money, which means you have a lot of friends, probably, that didn't have a lot of money either. What are a lot of your friends doing now? You guys have become multimillionaire, professional, marquee's a good word, marquee baseball players. What did a lot of your friends end up doing back from Seaforth and from Georgia?
Well, a lot of my friends are, I call it in the belly of the beast right now. They're in jail. And then a lot of them are still there trying to do the best they can.
Does it hurt you?
It does. It does. But everything happens for a reason, you know. Just like me getting the chicken pox this year.
Yeah, what was that reason? Give Mike Lansing a shot, I guess.
That's right. Because coming out of camp, he didn't expect to play a lot, you know. And then all of a sudden, I get sick, and boom, he's in there.
So you'll sacrifice your chicken pox for his 400 batting average?
That's right, as long as we win.
Marquise, what a lot of your friends
during my time growing up in high school, I didn't have real close friends. I had about three or four, and I still got them. I know a lot of people that, when I went off to college, that I knew, but they weren't really that close to me, that are, like he said, in jail, dead, or on drugs, or selling drugs, or whatever. But, you know, that was a thing, you know, back in 1985 or whenever we were in high school. But I had a couple of guys that I was real close to, and most of them are married and got families and doing well. And I only had like two or three, so, and two of my brothers. So I still got my same friends.
Is there anything that you guys feel that you could do, maybe if this much, to help the next generation of Afro-American young kids who are underprivileged, don't have maybe seemingly a shot? Anything you guys think you can do? Show them the right way, or tell them anyone can make it?
No, I think the best thing I could do is just to raise my son or my children, or I don't know if I'm gonna have any more. That's up to my wife, you know, but just raise my children and do the best by them. That's the best thing I think I can do.
What does history tell you, though?
That the family is important. That's what it tells me, and that's something that the black community right now is hurting. The family is hurting because the men are not there. And we have to be there for our kids. You know, we're making babies and this, that, and the other, but we're not really there raising them, and that's what it's all about. You know, you got to raise them up to be the persons that you want them to be.
And why has that happened?
The system. I mean, you know.
It didn't just start.
It's the system.
Is it getting better?
No.
You don't see any improvement at all? I mean, it's hard to see improvement. You watch CNN every night and you see gang warfare going on in the inner cities of every city.
Just watch the news, read the papers, and you can see it's not getting better.
And the family, to you, is that's where it's got to start, with the family.
That's right.
You feel the same way?
Yeah, because if my mom and dad didn't raise me the right way and, you know, left me out there to make decisions, you know, when I needed to make the right decision, you know, I probably wouldn't be here today. And it all started at home.
Do you guys have any faith in any politician anywhere, or any public figure anywhere who can make a difference?
I don't believe in nothing. I don't trust nobody. I just go.
That's a pretty tough negative attitude to have, though.
Cynical. I mean, but justified. That's probably justified.
Cynical. To a certain extent.
I think politicians are cynical. Right. We're not talking about that.
Yeah, that's fine. But I mean, has there anywhere been somebody who you said, yeah, you know, he or she is right, and if they had a chance?
I think probably the two best political people that have ever been on the scene are John F. Kennedy and Martin Luther King. And they both were killed. So that right there told me something. Somebody didn't want them around. So I don't see anybody else coming.
In your bio, in the media guide, at least in the 92 media guide, one of your idols was Malcolm X, so I would assume you would throw him in.
Well, I didn't really look at Malcolm as politically or political. You know, he was more spiritual and...
But he had the right idea?
Yeah.
Did you see the movie Malcolm X?
Yeah. Did you?
Yeah, of course I did. Mm. You like it? The way it was done?
Not really.
What didn't you like about
it? It was because it made it seem like the Muslims were solely responsible for killing this man, and that wasn't the way it was, you know. There was a lot of undermining that went on, you know. Just a lot was left out there that could have been told.
Surprise you that Spike Lee would leave some of that stuff out?
Well, ever since I heard what Spike said about Dion last year, was it?
Yeah.
I'm not surprised about this man, you know, even though I like his work and ever since then, I don't know about my man.
What did he say about Deion Sanders?
He basically, you probably maybe remember it better than I do. He was saying that Deion was white, basically. Deion is.
He was talking about how did they put this bum or this idiot on the cover. What was it? What was the magazine he was talking about?
It was
Sports Illustrated, maybe.
It might have been.
Anyway, he was just calling them all these names and stuff. And
he ripped apart Deion Sanders as not being representative of the black community at all and not really being an Afro-American at all. And there's a lot of controversy about that. Obviously, Deion just shook it right off. But someone like Delino, who's an Afro-American athlete, was unable to shake it off. Are you a Spike Lee fan?
What kind of movies do you like? I don't even go to movies.
What kind of movie? You don't go to movies at all?
I've been to 5 movies probably my whole lifetime.
You must have a favorite then. Not too tough to remember.
5 in your whole life.
I just don't go to movies.
Television? You watch any television?
Well, every now and then, you know, pass time, but don't really get into one certain, you know, big scene or anything. I watch Martin. That's about my favorite show. And that's it.
Martin who?
They don't show Martin
up here. A little slow, a little behind.
Yeah, is that Martin Lawrence a talk show?
No, he's got a
comedy.
Show.
It's a sitcom.
Okay. I got that. There's another sitcom. Now I'm drawing a blank. It's a black sitcom. Damon Wayans is in it.
Live
in Color. You ever watch that one?
Yeah, but
not one of your favorites.
To Martin, no.
Let me ask you guys playing. While we're on. We somehow got onto the subject about the Bill Cosby show. There are a lot of people who didn't like the representation of that family as being representative of what Black America was about, and they thought it was unrealistic. And others responded to that by saying, "Well, what do you mean? You can't have a successful Black family in America?" I mean, did you have any problems with the Cosby show?
Mm-mm. Thought it was a great show. And I feel like we all deserve to live like that. I mean, like the Huxtables were living. You know, they were living large, so to speak. But I feel like we all deserve the best things in life, you know. Nobody should be homeless, out there starving, and all that.
Bill Cosby's a doctor in that show. Mm-hmm. His wife is a lawyer in the show. Kids are all going to school. To me, that's a great show to have. Better to have a show like that than any other. Now great. You have the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, which is completely, I mean, different than Cosby. It's the high living, but more unrealistic, not because the characters are black, but just the way the whole show is put together. It's trying to take off on Cosby, but it's not. But I tend to agree with Marquise and Delano that's a good show. You got a lawyer and a doctor, why not? Not only
same kind of sweater.
Yeah.
Had a great collection of sweaters on this show. Who helped you the most in becoming a successful Major League Baseball player?
Good question. As far as what?
Somewhere along the way who may have had a little more input than somebody else, who you remember more fondly than somebody else, perhaps?
It's just a whole bunch of people. You know, my mom, my dad, my high school coach, college coach. But it all started, you know, with myself. Working hard. Didn't nobody tell me to work hard, do extra work. You know, didn't nobody steal on me all the time. You know, I had to drive myself, but a whole bunch of people just, you know, helped here and helped there, but to pick, you know, one person that really stood out, I really couldn't say.
What about yourself?
Like you said, there was a lot of people, but one man stands out in my mind. His name is Gene Glenn, and he was a coach with us some years ago, and he just stayed on me all the time, you know, he wanted to see me get better, and I want to say thanks if he's watching out there somewhere, you know.
Mm-hmm. He's getting better. What? Go ahead.
Now, were you in your neighborhood in Seaforth at 15, 16 years old?
Seaforth,
definitely.
Yeah.
Got it. Good. Were you the star of the neighborhood? I mean, Delino, you got to see Delino plays hoops, baseball. This guy's going to be a pro athlete one day. Was that the word? A lot of clippings in the Seaforth newspaper?
Yeah, well, there was a lot of clippers, but to me, I wasn't the best player in the neighborhood. You know, there were other guys that I even looked up to that did make it.
Has anyone ever come out of Seaforth other than you?
No.
You're like the Seaforth
We got a couple more on the rise right now, though. A kid with the Oakland organization, Mike Neal, and a kid that's with the Padres now. He was with Toronto last year. He got traded in the Darren Jackson deal, him and Derek Bell, Stoney Briggs. And another kid with the Brewers. So we got a few more coming.
Is there a sign yet as you enter Seaforth, Delaware, home of Delino?
Nah.
Haven't done that yet?
Nylon capital of the
you
world.
Got the key.
That's it.
How about you, Marquise? Were you like the man in the neighborhood when you were growing up?
No, like he said, you know, it was a lot of guys that I looked up to, too. Because I played with guys that were, you know, 5 and 6 years older than me, maybe 10. And I competed against them. I think that's a big reason why I was getting better.
His neighborhood was a lot bigger than mine, too. There's a lot of boys in his neighborhood.
Yeah, you had to hold your ground, too.
What's the deal with your socks now? Last year you had them up and you said it was your tribute to all of those who paved the way for you and the Negro League and so mm-hmm. on. Now they're back down.
Well, I still think I have a...
That baggy look.
Yeah.
Yeah, the baggy.
I mean, you know, it's still, it might be a different era now, you know. Maybe last year was the 20s or the 30s. Now it's moving on up.
You're like a chameleon. I mean, you change.
That's right.
You do it on purpose?
I do.
Try to keep people a little bit off.
Yeah. Try to keep, you know, this is my own thing, you know. So they can say, yeah, that's the Shields right there.
They've been saying a lot of that lately.
Mm-hmm. All the time. There you go.
Yeah.
Do you have as much an appreciation of the sport and the guys who went before you as Mr. DeShields does?
Oh, yeah, I do. You know, it went for those guys, wouldn't be no arbitration, no free agency and all of that. And I'll go back and I talk to Tommy Harper a lot, and he pretty much educate me on how it was back in the day. And, you know, we can't do anything but thank those guys and try to make it even better for the next generation that's coming to play ball.
You never had to drink from a water fountain that said, one said whites, one said blacks. You never had to go into a restaurant and say, no, you can't eat here, the rest of the team.
But see, that's what I was talking about earlier. I mean, Marquise grew up in the South and he saw a lot of that stuff, whereas I grew up in the North and I really didn't see it. And so now all of a sudden I get exposed to things like that at a later age, and I react more differently than he does, whereas he's more, when he sees stuff like that now, he doesn't, you know, react as quickly, you know, because he's seen all that and he knows how to handle it a bit better than I do. But for me, you know, I just can't, I don't tolerate things like that.
Are you angrier as a result?
I think
you're angrier than he is.
Yeah.
Is that fair?
Yeah.
And he helps me out. He helps me out with that stuff.
At the time, I was angry. I've been in a grocery store. I know I'm talking about this. This hasn't been about 20 years ago. I've seen a lady walk right in front of my mom in a grocery store, and just go, you know. So little things like that. But he has a right to be angry because that's not right. Period, but it's been going on for years and it hasn't changed, it's getting worse.
We'll continue this conversation about racism. We'll talk about Marquise's arbitration hearing a few months
Everybody
ago.
Everybody wanna talk about racism these days.
On the next edition of the
Sports
baseball. Hot Seat.
Yeah.
Exactly. We have some nice gifts from Starter though. Marquise is a big fan of Michael Jordan and the Chicago Bulls, whereby Delino is a big fan of Randall Cunningham, no longer Reggie White of the Philadelphia Eagles, and Starter's giving us a bunch of real nice stuff. We'll be back next week on the Sports Hot Seat with Marquise Grissom and Delino DeShields, and we'll continue. Thanks a lot.
Michael Jordan.
Sports Hot Seat is brought to you in part by Sport Buff in Plaza Lexus Neon, where you'll find the entire line of Starter sportswear.